Live in beautiful downtown Boston, this is the Jeff Santos Show on the Revolution Radio Network.
All right, we're going to try to see if we can bring in Mark Taylor-Canfield right now. Mark, great to have you back on the show. We'll give you an appropriate music intro coming up at 34 past. But just quickly here, I've got a couple of minutes. Talk to us a little bit about what is happening in Seattle and in Washington State right now with this coronavirus. How much has it affected your life and people you know?
The annual Women's March was canceled, and that in the past has drawn 130,000 people, Jeff.
Wow.
So that's a huge change, right? It's an annual event. It was postponed. There was actually a postponement from earlier in February because of weather conditions, and now, you know, because of this. So it was held online. And so all of the speakers and everybody that was involved on the stage or would have been involved on the stage actually had what you might call a webinar. And then, you know, so that's what happened there. We had Pearl Jam just cancel their tour for their new CD, which is really interesting, Jeff. You should check it out. And it is like their first CD since their Grammy Award-winning Lightning Bolt. So, you know, it was much anticipated. So that's kind of sad. However, I can say this, that even though Governor Inslee has called a declaration of emergency, he, you know, this happened, you know, weeks ago. Now, I am not a health reporter, so I left it to those who are have more expertise in this field to do the reporting. But he did declare a state of emergency early in the game weeks ago, and also so did Jenny Durkin, the mayor of Seattle. So the health department in Seattle has been on emergency alert. Everybody, you know, has been trying to be very careful. But I can tell you this, you know, there are musicians out there, and there are punk bands, and there are girl bands, which is what this was about, and they refused to back down. They had a big show at the Highline, and our you know, the person we all love, Juliana and her band, having issues, performed, along with a whole slew of all-girl bands, and they raised thousands of dollars for the Peoria House, which is a women's shelter, and, you know, they just refused to back down. So some people are just refusing to back off. And in the music world, you know, even though they're having a problem in California that's not directly related to the health situation, we can talk about that later, that's really affecting the music industry there. But here in Seattle, some people are still going to see shows. They're still going out. I have a feeling that there's probably less attendance at some of the shows and less people going out to eat and stuff. And I worry about my friends who work in the service industry and what may happen to their jobs because of this.
We'll be right here. We've got a heartbreak coming up. We're going to come back. A little proper introduction for our great friend Mark Taylor-Canfield. We're right back. It's the Jeff Santos Show. Back in a flash.
This is the Jeff Santos Show.
Well, it's not exactly Mark Taylor-Canfield's music or a little bit of the Seattle sound of Nirvana or Pearl Jam, but we'll do it. A little U2 for you. He is, of course, the Renaissance man here on the Jeff Santos Show and in real life in Seattle. Of course, he is a great journalist. You can follow him on Twitter, Democracy Watch News. Of course, you catch him here every Tuesday on the Jeff Santos Show at 5:30. Great to have, with a little bit of music intro, for the man who's also a fantastic musician, Mark Taylor-Canfield, MTC. Great to have you back. It's great to be back on the Revolution Radio Network, Mark, and you on it. All good,
yes.
Even though it's a crazy, crazy time in our country right now. How you doing?
I'm doing good, and I appreciate hearing The Who on the outro there, on the last segment, because I was just writing to some friends yesterday about that song and, you know, Hope We Don't Get Fooled Again, and just how iconic that song is and how artists and musicians seem to capture those moments, like the, you know, the times they are a-changin' was the most popular song by our own amazing vocal artist. Well, Dave Matthews was there, and so was Brandi Carlile. Brandi Carlile sang this song at a student-organized anti-NRA function at Seattle Center, and that was the most popular song of the entire event. You know, Dave Matthews got up there and sang some of his band's music and stuff, but when Brandi Carlile played a Bob Dylan song, the entire crowd started singing the lyrics, and that was, like, the revolutionary moment of the day. That's when Jay Inslee told the crowd, the governor of Connecticut was there, they told the crowd, you know what, we're just going to step aside because it's the young people who know what's up, and the sooner we turn over this state and our government to these young folks, the better off the world is going to be, and that was pretty much all I had to say that day.
Yeah,
it was a beautiful moment.
Yeah, no, that's fantastic news. And, you know, look, remiss, you got a big primary today in Seattle. And, you know, but I want so many things to talk about. I don't know if we have enough time in this segment, but we'll try to offer you back. Maybe we'll do one of these deals where we'll get you back on Friday as well. But, you know, I want to start first with, you know, what has happened in Kirkland. I'm just wondering what kind of, you know, journalism has been done on who these people are. And, you know, and is it just the scenario that they are in such a close contact? You know, they all eat together, so on and so forth. And is that how it has happened? Can you give us any insight?
It's really hard to say. One, because it's not something that I've been covering as a journalist. Two, the details are sketchy because there are issues with confidentiality and, you know, people's personal medical histories and records. So there's a lot of doctor-patient confidentiality, but the health department and the state, I think, are as on top of the issue as you can be during these times. I think that Governor Inslee and Mayor Jenny Durkan were some of the first leaders in the U.S. to step out and call an emergency and say, we need to do something about this because of the fact that, yeah, there was in Martin Luther King Jr. County here near Seattle was actually the first fatality. So, yes, it's been an issue, but at the same time, I've also been watching other things going on around the country, including this primary, which is so, so important, and which, you know, we all should be paying attention for sure to that story. But there's also other things that have been going on, like I was part of a webinar the other day with Public Citizen about the Declaration for Democracy. These are the kind of stories that aren't actually getting reported because of these other breaking stories, but 145 groups in a coalition have formed to try to push a new pro-democracy movement in the United States, and they were able to get H.R. 1 introduced, which is the For the People Act, and I think that that's a really, really important piece of legislation that changes the way that we hold elections and do democracy in this country. And it actually has a chance, Jeff, especially if the Democrats can get a majority and hopefully get somebody in the White House, you know, to support it. But right now there is a bill in the Congress called the For the People Act, which has got some bipartisan support actually at the moment. So those are the stories that I've been trying to pay attention to at the same time that we're looking at this huge movement across the country with the Bernie Sanders phenomena. And that I've always considered to be an expansion of the franchise, a healthy step towards more direct democracy in the United States. And so I tend to cover that as executive director for Democracy Watch News. And here in Washington State, yes, we had a mail-in primary, so we probably will still be counting votes for the rest of the week. It's not going to be quite as bad as what's going on in California, where the Secretary of State said that 30 days is their timeline. They're saying, like, you know, a month after the election, they might have the results that will tell us exactly what the delegate count will be. Yeah, well, here in Seattle and in the Washington State, it won't be quite that bad. A lot of people have already voted. Bernie Sanders is quite popular in the Puget Sound area, of course, and
no doubt.
Popped them in at the Tacoma Dome with 17,000 people on about 3 days' notice. So people are...
You were there all over MSNBC and everything else, Mark. That's awesome. Well, let me ask you this, because, you know, I think that this all goes into it. There's this real movement of young people, you know, for Bernie Sanders in places like Seattle, San Francisco and Los Angeles. You see it quite a bit, also in Portland, which hasn't voted yet. And the western part of the country has really gone solidified for Bernie Sanders. He's won Nevada, Utah, California, even though they haven't called it yet. The networks haven't. AP has. It's a disgrace on that side of things. But, you know, he gave Biden a run for his money in Texas, and if all those Latino voters who were stuck in line voted, who knows, maybe Bernie could have sneaked that out too. But I just wondering about the young voter. It's a little different in the Pacific West than it is here, well, I shouldn't say here, but in the Midwest. And it obviously wasn't that big a factor in Massachusetts. You know, Biden won that. And even though there's a large college population in Boston, they maybe were divided between Warren and Sanders. And that probably could have cost Sanders in the end, as many analysts are saying, that Warren, if she dropped out a week before, days before, like her colleagues Klobuchar and Buttigieg, maybe, just maybe, Bernie could have won Massachusetts, Minnesota, which he won handily last time, and of course even Maine, nearby to Vermont. So what are you seeing with young people? Is it as strong as what you witnessed, you know, firsthand, those 17,000 at the Tacoma Dome, whatever it was, or is it not as much as we're saying it is for young people?
Well, we can all agree, and Bernie Sanders himself has said this in his recent appeals, that he's very popular across the country in the age group of like 17 to 44, which he did quite well with in South Carolina, by the way. Mm-hmm. So there's a sharp divide. There's this generation gap that's really a sharp divide across the country about Bernie Sanders. And the fact that the establishment doesn't like him is what makes him so popular, because when you're a young person, of course you feel the same way, right?
Right, exactly.
The establishment doesn't accept me. I'm discredited and discounted because I'm just a kid or whatever. So, you know, it was like I wrote this short story and published it on Twitter the other day, and part of it was with the Democratic Party leadership hanging out in their Armani suits and their Gucci shoes saying, you know, why do all you young kids want your grandpa to be U.S. president? And they just said, because he's such a cool grandpa. I mean, the guy really is. And if you think about it, why did a lot of people vote for Trump? Because the establishment actually didn't like him that much at the time, even though the corporate news media was pushing and pushing him. Now, of course, they're pushing Joe Biden, which creates a whole other sense that Bernie's the underdog, the establishment's against him, he represents change, represents a new generation of people entering American politics. But he admitted himself, Jeff, that the 17 to 44 crowd, they don't vote as much. And so there's a uphill battle to get these people to the polls. And I'm not going to make any predictions, because we've learned over the last 4 years not to do that, you know, as far as politics in the United States are concerned. But I can say that there is a continuing movement. And one of the things I thought was really interesting was that during the Tacoma Dome event in the Seattle area here, one of the speakers was Shama Sawant, who is actually a member of the Socialist Alternative Party and also our kind of world-famous, internationally recognized city council member, who's quite a firebrand on progressive issues and working class issues. Well, she was at Bernie's event. She is not a Democrat, by the way. I mean, this is not the first time that she's been at a Bernie Sanders event. So you're seeing this coalition that goes beyond the Democratic Party. And one of the things that she was saying was that we actually need a party that represents the working people of this country, and we don't have it with the Democrats. That's her attitude. Now, she didn't say, don't vote for a Democrat, because, you know, like everybody else, she would love to see somebody else rather than Trump in the White House. But this whole idea that democratic socialism is going to somehow change everything overnight, well, there's a pushback against it. And it's coming from the establishment. It's coming from the Wall Street crowd that's in control of the Democrats and the Republicans. And, you know, it remains to be seen where this movement will go. But it's not going to go away. I can guarantee you that, Jeff. This is the new style of politics in the United States, and a lot of the young folks involved with it are going to continue to be active politically in one way or another. Now, the Democrats can either welcome them into the party, or they can try to shut them out again like they did during the last convention, and then where do they go? Yeah. And that's the question.
Well, yeah, they stay home, and that's the thing that they have to worry about. Talking with my good friend Mark Taylor-Canfield, our Renaissance man here on the Jeff Santos Show. I want to switch a little bit, because I think this goes right to the heart of young people, and maybe it opens their eyes. Now, look, but he's still, Eddie Vedder and company are still out there, you know, doing the right thing. Their tours have been canceled, as well as a whole a slew of them. Green Day, I think, canceled recently. you know, what do you make of this, and how does it affect people when they see this? They're still aiming at a young audience, these bands, still have a young following. Does it open the eyes of younger people and say, you know, my vote counts? You know, I got to be worried here because, you know, they're canceling, you know, places where I want to go to get away from all the nonsense of what goes on in Washington and, you know, in big business across the country and our friends, you know, Bezos and company. Is there at all that sort of connection going on?
Well, Amazon has also been criticized for not giving enough information to its employees and not doing enough. But, you know, that's going around because there's a lack of information. And I would just say that people do respect Pearl Jam in Seattle quite a lot. They had two major shows at Safeco Field last year that raised millions of dollars for projects to try to end homelessness, which is such a major issue here, like in other major cities across the country, which is another reason why people are turning towards democratic socialism, because they think they see capitalists not working for a growing number of people around the country.
Mm-hmm.
But I would say, yeah, it does make people sit up and take notice. It has affected the music industry. And unfortunately, down there in California, where they're still counting the 3 million votes, they've also had a double whammy to their music industry because, unfortunately, although it was well-intentioned, the bill AB5 pretty much is starting to wipe out the independent music industry in California. And it was meant to make sure that workers were protected. But unfortunately, you know, as musicians, we do a lot of freelancing, and we hire different musicians for each show. And so it gets complicated with contracts. And because of the way the law is set up, it's really hurt the music industry there. The only person I know that's doing a really good job of covering that is a guy named Ari Hurston, who has worked with a lot of Grammy Award-winning musicians. And he has a blog called Ari's Take, where he's trying to explain what's going on in California. He's also lobbying the assembly down there and the governor to try to amend this law because it's wiping out the music industry. But if you go to California and you get this double whammy where now people don't want to show up at your shows, it's going to hurt the bands, it's going to hurt the music industry, and it's another effect on the economy as a whole, which is not good. And I also talked about my worries about small businesses not getting as much business because people don't want to go out, they don't want to gather in large crowds and places, so they're not going to rock concerts as much and things. So I can only hope, you know, for better days, Jeff, and that people can get control of this and that we do all do the right thing, whether it's our government leaders, our educators, and healthcare workers. We all got to figure this out together. This is not a Republican versus Democrat issue. This is not us versus them. It's a sort of like Bernie was saying, it's not me, it's us. And we all have to work together on it, no matter what our political point of views are.
I think you said it well, Mark Taylor-Canfield. I would say this, is I think that a lot of people have to learn not only about the coronavirus, but about how government is so critical. And, you know, seeing it up close and personal, of course, with Jay Inslee, Governor Cuomo up in New York or down in New York, however you look at it geographically, has the National Guard out. And we know the National Guard doesn't come out unless there's, a major catastrophe in the state. Usually it's social unrest, riots that causes this, and it's now because of a healthcare crisis in the New Rochelle area, just north of New York City. People have to be alerted. I mean, you have the head of the CDC, Mr. Fauci, speaking as we talk to you now about, you know, what is going on and how to deal with this. And I think it's really important that people understand that a good government and government that's prepared for this, not a government that's, you know, doing things on the fly because their president doesn't want to have bad news and bad numbers for his polling. Is the absentee ballot, you know, protecting people in a sense that they don't have to actually go into a voting booth where, of course, you touch the voting booth, you touch the voting screen, you touch all the things, the table that you sign in usually. Is that helping the scenario of this coronavirus crisis in Seattle and greater Seattle?
Oh, yes, because it's all mail-in voting. I mean, the only thing you're touching is your own envelope that came through the mail. So, I meant to say this when you asked about Pearl Jam and Eddie Vedder, because I was just following their tweets. And the issue here is not just the band canceling their concert, but the tweets that went out from the band and from Eddie saying that, you know, we aren't getting enough information from our government. that makes it difficult for us as a band to make these decisions. And so it would be much better and much more helpful if we had more information on what was going on. And that was, you know, became sort of a political issue here in Seattle, where people started retweeting that and saying, you know, yeah, you know, although in Washington State our elected officials are doing the best they can, I think on a national level people need to do a better job. And that was what kind of the message of the band was.
Yeah, it's no doubt that there are issues here that need to be dealt with. Talking with Mark Taylor Canfield here on the Jeff Santos Show. Getting back to the Bernie Sanders situation, one of the things that to me has been really frustrating as a Sanders supporter has been the fact that the corporate media, which you and I, of course, rail on in some tremendous tweets over the last week or so about this, Mark, and I commend you as somebody who's been talking about the protection of journalists and so forth. Unfortunately, too many corporate journalists to sort of go along with the company line. Or their editor's line. But I think that it is incumbent upon Bernie Sanders, because the general media, mainstream media, doesn't tell the truth on what democratic socialism is. And what I've been saying on the show over the last couple of days is that I think he should go to Hyde Park, New York, which I think is a little bit further away from Westchester County, where the New Rochelle problem is. It's not that far, but it's enough away to do an event and to make it clear of who he is and what democratic socialism is and the connection to FDR and what Roosevelt did for this country and what Bernie Sanders can follow on that second Bill of Rights, of course, that never was really put into fruition because Roosevelt died in 1945 and Harry Truman couldn't pass it. He did introduce single-payer health care, interestingly enough, but they couldn't get that through, and that was the beginning of many problems. I'm just wondering, that if you agree with me that Bernie, because of the corporate media not telling the truth and not really understanding what has happened across the world or even just to the north in Canada, not far from you where you are in Vancouver, there's nobody running down, warning Americans, oh, you don't want to have single payer. It's awful. Medicare for all. It's awful, awful, awful. On the other hand, they're very, very happy. In fact, hockey players who played in
Canada, and a lot of the young folks involved with it are going to continue to be active politically in one way or another. Now, the Democrats can either welcome them into the party or they can try to shut them out again like they did during the last convention. And then where do they go? Yeah. And that's the question.
Well, yeah, they stay home, and that's the thing that they have to worry about. Talking with my good friend Mark Taylor Canfield, our Renaissance man here on the Jeff Santos Show. I want to switch a little bit because I think this goes right to the heart of young people, and maybe it opens their eyes. Now, look, I have no doubt that, a lot of 18-year-olds may consider Pearl Jam, too old, but they still, Eddie Vedder and company, are still out there, doing the right thing. Their tours have been canceled, as well as a whole a slew of them. Green Day, I think, canceled recently. What do you make of this, and how does it affect, young people? When they see this, do they take the coronavirus maybe a little more seriously? Again, I know these bands are people that are my age and closer to your age than they are of somebody who's 18 or 22, but they're still, aiming at a young audience, these bands, still have a young following. Does it open the eyes of younger people and say, my vote counts? I got to be worried here because, they're canceling, places where I want to go to get away from all the nonsense of what goes on in Washington and, in big business across the country and our friends, Bezos and company. Is there at all that sort of connection going on?
Well, Amazon has also been criticized for not giving enough information to its employees and not doing enough. But that's going around because there's a lack of information. And I would just say that people do respect Pearl Jam in Seattle quite a lot. They had two major shows at Safeco Field last year that raised millions of dollars for projects to try to end homelessness, which is such a major issue here, like in other major cities across the country, which is another reason why people are turning towards democratic socialism, because they see capitalists not working for a growing number of people around the country. Mm-hmm. But I would say, yeah, it does make people sit up and take notice it has affected the music industry. And unfortunately, down there in California, where they're still counting the 3 million votes, they've also had a double whammy to their music industry because, unfortunately, although it was well-intentioned, the Bill AB 5 pretty much is starting to wipe out the independent music industry in California. And it was meant to make sure that workers were protected, you know, but unfortunately, you know, us musicians, we do a lot of freelancing and we hire different musicians for each show. And so it gets complicated with contracts. And because of the way the law is set up, it's really hurt the music industry there. The only person I know that's doing a really good job of covering that is a guy named Ari Hurston, who has worked with a lot of Grammy Award winning musicians. And he has a blog called Ari's Take, where he's trying to explain what's going on in California. He's also lobbying the assembly down there and the governor to try to, you know, try to amend this law because it's wiping out the music industry. But if you go to California and you get this double whammy where now people don't want to show up at your shows, it's going to hurt the bands, it's going to hurt the music industry, and it's another effect on the economy as a whole, which is not good. And I also talked about my worries about small businesses not getting as much business because people don't want to go out, they don't want to gather in large crowds in places, so they're not going to rock concerts as much and things. So I can only hope, you know, for better days, Jeff, and that people can get control of this and that we do all do the right thing, whether it's our government leaders, our educators, and healthcare workers. We all got to figure this out together. This is not a Republican versus Democrat issue. This is not us versus them. It's a sort of like Bernie was saying, it's not me, it's us. And we all have to work together on it no matter what our political point of views are. But, you know, in general, I would say
no doubt. I think you said it well, Mark Taylor-Canfield. I would say this, is I think that a lot of people have to learn not only about the coronavirus, but about how government is so critical. And, you know, seeing it up close and personal, of course, with Jay Inslee, Governor Cuomo up in New York or down in New York, however you look at it geographically, has the National Guard out. And we know the National Guard doesn't come out unless there's, a major catastrophe in the state. And, you know, usually it's social unrest, riots, that causes this, and it's now because of a healthcare crisis in the New Rochelle area, just north of New York City. And, you know, I think that people have to be alerted. I mean, you have the head of the CDC, Mr. Fauci, speaking as we talk to you now about, you know, what is going on and how to deal with this. And I think it's really important that people understand that a good government and government that's prepared for this, not a government that's, you know, doing things on the fly because their president doesn't want to have bad news and bad numbers for his polling. I mean, you know, this insane kind of concept of this, monster of a man and Donald Trump. But let me ask you another aspect of what's going on, today. Is the absentee ballot, protecting people in a sense that they don't have to actually go into a voting booth where, of course, you touch the voting booth, you touch the voting screen, you touch all the things, the table that you sign in usually. Is that helping the scenario of this coronavirus crisis in Seattle and greater Seattle?
Oh, yes, because it's all mail-in voting. I mean, the only thing you're touching is your own envelope that came through the mail. So, I meant to say this when you asked about Pearl Jam and Eddie Vedder, because I was just following their tweets. And the issue here is not just the band canceling their concert, but the tweets that went out from the band and from Eddie saying that, you know, we aren't getting enough information from our government. That makes it difficult for us as a band to make these decisions. And so it would be much better and much more helpful if we had more information on what was going on. And that was, you know, became sort of a political issue here in Seattle, where people started retweeting that and saying, you know, yeah, you know, although in Washington State our elected officials are doing the best they can, I think on a national level people need to do a better job. And that was what kind of the message of the band was.
Yeah, it's no doubt that there are issues here that need to be dealt with. Talking with Mark Taylor-Canfield here on the Jeff Santos Show. You know, getting back to the Bernie Sanders situation, one of the things that to me has been really frustrating as a Sanders supporter has been the fact that the corporate media, which you and I, of course, rail on in some tremendous tweets over the last week or so about this, Mark, and I commend you as somebody who's been talking about the protection of journalists and so forth. Unfortunately, too many corporate journalists to sort of go along with the company line. Or their editor's line. But I think that it is incumbent upon Bernie Sanders, because the general media, mainstream media, doesn't tell the truth on what democratic socialism is. And what I've been saying on the show over the last couple of days is that I think he should go to Hyde Park, New York, which I think is a little bit further away from Westchester County, where the New Rochelle problem is. It's not that far, but it's enough away to do an event and to make it clear of who he is and what democratic socialism is and the connection to FDR and what Roosevelt did for this country and what Bernie Sanders can follow on that second Bill of Rights, of course, that never was really put into fruition because Roosevelt died in 1945, Harry Truman couldn't pass it. He did introduce single-payer health care, interestingly enough, but they couldn't get that through, and that was the beginning of many problems. I'm just wondering, that if you agree with me that Bernie, because of the corporate media not telling the truth and not really understanding what has happened across the world or even just to the north in Canada, not far from you where you are in Vancouver, there's nobody running down, warning Americans, oh, you don't want to have single payer. It's awful. Medicare for all. It's awful, awful, awful. On the other hand, they're very, very happy. In fact, hockey players who played in Canada and grew up in Canada want to leave the United States and other parts of the world, particularly the United States, and go back to Canada and live because they know they got their health care paid for. Talk to me about that if you can, because I think Sanders has to do the job that most journalists should be doing if they were given the opportunity, without meddlers from corporate media, particularly at MSNBC and CNN. Your thoughts?
Well, the framework that the corporate media wants you to look through just serves their owner's interests. So
exactly.
I wouldn't look to them to find out what's really going on behind the scenes. I mean, there's a corporate line that they're going to repeat, and they are all kind of like sharks, they all surround the same story. But in general, there's a very interesting thing happening in the United States, which, it's being framed right now, but for political reasons, of course. You and I both know that politics is about perception. So the right wing wants people to be afraid of Bernie Sanders. And for all I know, their friends in the corporate media that have been pushing that line may have been slightly successful at this point, because it does seem like he's not winning as many primaries as we expected. So, because if you remember right, the corporate media was... They were having a meltdown, basically. They were really having a nervous breakdown, and you saw it with Chris Matthews and others when Bernie was the front runner. They could not handle it. They literally lost their composure live on the air multiple times, and it was embarrassing for everyone watching it. So now they have their wish. They've got, the corporate guy out front, which is, now they can relax and get along and go hang out with the same crowd they've been hanging out with in the establishment for years. I'm just saying that the Bernie Sanders phenomenon isn't going to go away, and it's not about democratic socialism, actually. I did kind of criticize folks like Paul Krugman for saying that Bernie Sanders shouldn't call himself a democratic socialist. I'm like, I would not condescend to tell anybody how they should describe themselves, politically, or what their religion should be, or, that's kind of a personal, private thing. I think it's up to Bernie Sanders to decide for himself what he wants to call himself. And Paul Krugman, he said it was very, how do you explain it? Self-exploitative or something to say that or something. And I'm thinking, that's kind of the same way for you, Paul, to go after Bernie Sanders and tell him what he should call himself. Whatever you want to call it, it's a change in progressive politics. And for some reason, we have this country where it's almost like two nations, where you have the West Coast and the Northeast, and then the rest of the country where they're just not, parts of the country like the upper Midwest, they're not quite sure, but in the rest of the country, they're pretty sure that they like this guy who's president because he's kind of a jerk and they appreciate it for whatever reason. And I'm thinking, there's a new politics going on in other parts of the country that is not turning more red. It's turning very blue and it's turning very, very progressive and it's getting more like Bernie Sanders, who is not an extremist in any way. And exactly. Anybody who tells you that is also just towing the corporate line again. Now there's some more scare tactics. I accused Trump in my latest animated cartoon on YouTube of being a McCarthyist kind of person, using McCarthyism.
Well, I mean, his hero
is... tell Bernie Sanders he's a communist.
You know? Roy Cohn, who was, of course, McCarthy's top aide. You know, I need my Roy Cohn. No, you're exactly right, Mark. And I think it's really critical that you know, alternative media, people like you and I and others that are out there, you know, continue to speak truth to power. We had Ryan Grimm on from The Intercept the other day, Lee Fong, of course, another great journalist, and, of course, Greg Palast was supposed to be on today. I'm going to probably have him on Thursday, talking again about election integrity and so forth. You know, this is what needs to be done, and hopefully Bernie can prevail, you know, catch up tonight in Michigan and so forth. All important stuff. Mark, we got to run, my friend, but again, thank you for doing what you do every day. It's so critical to have great journalism, and you are an example of that, my friend. Thank you.
Thank you for you and all your great guests. It's a great show. I appreciate it very much, the platform to speak like this on these issues. Thank you.
Thank you. Mark Taylor-Canfield right here on the Jeff Santos Show. I want to thank Ron Kreider for producing this broadcast. Thank you for listening. We'll be back tomorrow. Keep on fighting, folks. Go, Bernie, go. My name is Jeff Santos, and I gotta go.